It's time for the Phil Ferguson Show.
Well, hello there. This is Phil Ferguson, and you are listening to the cleverly titled The Phil Ferguson Show. Got a fun show for you today. I think it's a fun show. I'm going to kind of get into the weeds, and really the only segment is quite ranty. It's about an email that I got from a listener, and it set me off a little bit because it had the phrase, let me see if I can get to it. You are grossly misinformed. It's one of those things that if you send an email to somebody that has been doing their job for 25 years, maybe be a little more gentle coming in. Don't come in so hot. I responded kind of point by point to the email in the rant you're about to hear. And the author did have a follow-up email, which I'm going to talk about in the final segment, that did clarify and present itself better and more thoughtful. So I do appreciate that. And their response to my response was probably nicer than I deserved. So I thank you for that as well. And again, we're getting into some fine point details here, very specific things that probably won't affect a whole lot of investors in a material way. But here it is. I got this email. The other content I was going to have this week or this episode gets bumped to the next episode. And as I hinted at before, I'm doing some traveling, including going to the American Atheist Convention in Atlanta, Georgia. So this show is being released at that time. So I am away. I am in Atlanta, at least when this show drops. I'm going to schedule it to drop on that time frame. So that'll be kind of cool. But, you know, I'm looking forward to going to that. And you will enjoy the very technical and maybe a little bit too snarky response from me to the email, and then a couple of follow-up items at the end. And I think, you know, just a really, really short summary if you don't want to listen to all the technical details. ETF versus index funds at Vanguard, the differences are pretty much non-significant, non-meaningful. Do whatever you like. The overriding factor for me has been and still is an ETF allows you to trade during the day. I don't want you to trade during the day. I don't want you to be able to trade during the day. I don't want you to know that you can trade during the day. That's why I want mutual funds, because it's that little extra block that prevents you from doing something in a little bit of a panic. So if that prevents you from doing a mistake, all the differences that I'm going to talk about in the upcoming segment are insignificant compared to doing something like that. So that's kind of where I fall and where I still fall. Take a quick little break, doing something lighthearted, maybe fun here for one of the additional audios that I put in. And then we'll go into the email, the review, technical discussion of ETFs versus index funds, regular mutual funds. And, you know, we'll enjoy, and hopefully I'll see you at the American Atheist Convention in Atlanta.
My mum only lied to me about one thing. She said there was a God. And but that's because when you're a working class mum, Jesus is like an unpaid babysitter. Do you know what I mean? It's just sort of like, she wants you to be good. You know, the best of working class mum where I grew up, could she doesn't hope that I'd be a doctor or a lawyer. She hoped I wouldn't be stabbed to death in a barroom fight, you know. So the best thing to do is, well, if he's God-fearing, then he'd be good. It's a good rule of thumb because, you know, I went to Sunday school from about the age of 4 till 8. There was just great teachings of Jesus. I love Jesus. He was my superhero. He really was. God was magic, right? But Jesus was just a man. And what I loved about Jesus was he was kind. And he was brave, and I thought he was amazing. And I thought he was brilliant, like, just a brilliant guy, you know. So I was about 8, and my brother must have been 19. He came in once, and I was doing something from the Bible, and I said, what are you doing? I said, oh, drawing Jesus. And he went, who was Jesus? I said, well, he was the son of God. He went, why do you believe in God? Right? And my mum went, Bob, shut up. And I knew she had something to hide. And he was telling the truth. And I knew from body language. And then I worked it out, and I was an atheist in an hour.
In an hour?
Yeah.
The Phil Ferguson Show is for educational and entertainment purposes only. Nothing said on the show should be interpreted as personalized investment advice. Investments should be based on your personal situation, and you, of course, should consult with your financial advisor or tax professional before taking any actions.
You're listening to The Phil Ferguson Show.
Well, I've got another email, and this is a correction email that I received from a segment I did about why a mutual fund company, why an ETF company might advertise their ETFs to promote more people wanting to buy them, where I talked about ETFs in general and the comparison of ETFs versus, at least in my head, and maybe I wasn't clear, against index funds and particularly Vanguard index funds. So I got an email from a listener that had some concerns about the things that I said, and I'm going to go through that email and discuss probably 90% of what they said. And I think what I said holds up, at least in spirit, if not in fact. Although the author of the email does have a legitimate concern that I may have overplayed some of the problems with ETFs. I don't know. You can decide. I think about it. But I was pointing out problems with ETFs. It was not a global comparison that an ETF is always better or worse than an index fund from Vanguard, but why an ETF may not be as magical as you think they might be. So I'm going to kind of go forward on that basis. And I want to grab too many screens open here. I'm just going to read the first couple of lines from this, and the author will know because they're obviously a regular listener. And I'm going to send them an email response with all the links that I'm going to mention about here. And of course, there's always the danger that when I talk on a subject that's very complicated, ETFs, taxes, mutual funds, kind of off the cuff, there's room to make some mistakes. But let's take a look at them, and let's take a look at the things that are brought up in this email. I'll start with your quote. In episode 415, you gave a brief overview that contained many inaccuracies on the transactional costs of an ETF. I believe you act in good faith, but nevertheless, you are grossly misinformed as to the magnitude and the effects of the issues you brought up. I was doing pretty good until grossly misinformed. And of course, many inaccuracies. It's a lot like when I get responses from people about Bitcoin. Now, this does not go that far, but when I get a response from Bitcoin, it's often everything you said is wrong. Okay, great. Here it says many inaccuracies. And then below, there are several things that they think are inaccuracies. So I thank you for that. You know who you are. I thank you for being detailed and listing the things that you have concerns with. But grossly misinformed. Huh. All right. Fair enough. Let's take a look. And now I'm going to go to the essence of the email response here. And then here, this is another quote from the email. You mentioned that ETF issuers, in parentheses, BlackRock, Vanguard, and State Street, are the three largest. Great. Continuing on with the quote, directly trade on the market themselves. This is not true. And I thought to myself, I guess trade would be the right word. In the context of the segment, I was talking about BlackRock getting more people to want to buy shares of their ETFs. And so they would have to create more shares of the ETF. I didn't go through all the complexities and the varieties of how that can happen. But I did suggest that, at least in this case, BlackRock could do that. I don't think I mentioned State Street at all, and I probably always mention Vanguard whether I think about it or not. But the statement here is that this is not true. Just flat out not true. And I thought, wow, I guess I didn't research that specifically for the show segment, so let me take a look. And I found a document, a filing from BlackRock with the SEC talking about how things work. And in this filing, they outline what they can and can't do, what they might do, all kinds of things like that. So I'm going to read from this section called Assets Under Management, AUM Risk. And this is from the SEC filing. And if anyone wants the specific link and really wants to dig into this, I'll give it to you. But I'm hoping that most people are common sense enough to know that this is probably not worth their time to get to these esoteric nuances, or not even esoteric, but the details, the nitty gritty. So I'm going to quote, from time to time, an authorized participant, as defined in the creation and redemption section of the prospectus, a third-party investor, the fund's advisor, or an affiliate of the fund's advisor, or a fund may invest in the fund and hold its investments for a specific period of time in order to facilitate commencement of the fund's operations or to allow the fund to achieve size and scale, end quote. And the really important parts in relationship to the segment that I did was that there are often another organization, a third-party investor, an advisor to the affiliate, or another financial institution that facilitates the creation or the destruction of additional shares. And the author of the email pointed that out. And I agree. I was trying to keep it simple, maybe oversimplified. That is probably the bulk of how additional shares get created. But this specifically says that the fund, the fund or the fund advisor or the fund may, doesn't mean they have to, but they have the ability to go in and buy or sell shares for the purpose of commencement of operations, which requires, because you have to have all the money and create all the shares of the ETF before you go and sell them on the market, or to achieve size or scale, which was the very specific purpose of my previous discussion, is why would somebody like BlackRock promote and advertise their ETFs if there aren't more? You would just push up the price of the ETFs. Well, they could just create more shares, or more shares can be created. They may not be created by BlackRock, but they have the ability to do so, as detailed in this filing with the SEC. There's a continuation of this quote here. Quote, there can be no assurance that any such entity would not redeem its investments, or that the size of the fund would be maintained at such levels which could negatively impact the fund. So basically, they can make shares, they can take away shares. It can be the fund itself. It can be the advisor or the affiliate of the fund. It could be a third party person. So there's a lot of wiggle room in there. But basically, maybe there's some little nuance of what I said that might not be accurate. But I think I'm just going to give it a thumbs up that what I said, that BlackRock does have the capacity and the ability to create or get rid of shares. And we'll get into more of why that's possible, even within this episode. So they can do that. So the fact that the previous thing in the email that this is not true, their claim that it's not true is mistaken. It is true. They can. Whether they do or not, they probably at some point do. It may not be the primary mechanism, but they have, at least in this SEC filing, BlackRock reserved the right to do so. So, and then here we have another one. Quote, in fact, the issuers do not want the trade on the primary market as that would destroy the tax efficiency ETFs hold over other mutual funds. Wow, that's a lot to unpack. And sometimes I have problems with this, so maybe I misunderstand the intent. And so again, if you're the author of this email, and you'll know who you are, I am glad that you sent me something. But the issuers do not want to. Boy, I don't know. How does one know what BlackRock does or does not want to do unless they tell you? I mean, if you have a document that says they don't want to do this, cool. Maybe they don't want to. I don't think I ever talked about their desire to. Maybe I did. Maybe it's implied. But I don't know how one can say that they don't want to. And then it says here, as that would destroy the tax efficiency ETFs hold over mutual funds. I have no fucking clue how it would destroy the tax efficiency, if it even exists, and even if it's better than mutual funds. That to me just didn't follow at all. Again, maybe I misunderstand. And then another thing, and I've had specific segments on this, the tax efficiency of an ETF versus a mutual fund. Almost every time you see that claim, that title, that concept, when you're looking at something written somewhere on the internet, assuming, of course, that they're being straight up and legitimate and not just a puff piece or trying to really grab your attention, the essence of the article almost always, at least all the ones that I've read, comes down to comparing an ETF to a managed mutual fund. A lot of ETFs are passive investments. They're like an index fund. If you are comparing a passive ETF to an averaged managed mutual fund, the ETF will very likely come out as being materially more tax efficient. I think that falls under the category of duh. But if you compare a ETF to a Vanguard index fund that is also wickedly highly tax efficient, you will find that if there is a difference, it is non-material. I looked for and I couldn't find, and maybe I can find, I think I saved a copy. Vanguard had previously issued a white paper, and I did a segment specifically on this a couple of years ago, that for all practical purposes, as far as they are concerned, the ETF version of their ultra low cost and highly tax efficient index funds is non-significant, non-meaningful. I don't want to say it didn't exist. It might be 1 or 2 basis points. So there might be some distinction, but is it worth it? At this point, maybe I'm stuck using the mutual funds and the index funds from Vanguard because that's what I've been using. And maybe there's a teeny weeny little room for improvement, but I'm still concerned that what is generally accepted as the biggest perk of an ETF is still the biggest problem of an ETF. And that is that you can trade it in real time, at least while the market is open. I don't want people doing that. I don't want people having the ability to do that. You will get more tempted to see something in the news and go say, I want to go buy or sell, and I want to do that right now, which you can do in an ETF. I don't want you to even think that you can do that. With a mutual fund, it's at the end of the day. So if at noon you think the market is going badly and you think, well, I'm going to sell this mutual fund before it goes down, you can't sell it before it goes down. If the market continues down at the end of the day and then you go, well, shit, it kept going down and now I'm locked in. I can't avoid the drop. But if it bounces back and comes back up at the end of the day, you've avoided the problem that you may have created for yourself if you had an ETF by selling because now you fucking want to buy it back and whatever. So I think that's the most significant thing in my mind. And again, there's room for argument here, professional difference of opinion. At least as far as comparing ETFs, Vanguard ETFs to Vanguard index funds, I don't think there's enough of a difference in that regard to consider ETFs. They're not bad. And it's actually, it's probably better for an ETF if you have a small amount, maybe. But if your account is at Vanguard, investing in the ETF may cost you something where investing in the Vanguard fund, it won't. And we're going to talk more about costs later in this email. And let's see here. I have, let's see, this, I'm going to make sure this is my thought. This is me. Vanguard says that you may have to pay taxes on realized gains and gains realized by the fund. Because one of the things that's often said is that ETFs don't have taxes or don't pass through taxes. Well, that's crazy. Cray cray. Absolutely cray cray. The idea that you can own an ETF and not pay taxes is just wrong. Just absolutely wrong. So here's a quote from a webpage on Vanguard's quote, just as with individual securities, when you sell shares of a mutual fund or ETF for a profit, you'll owe taxes on that realized gain. I'm going to stop there and end quote. It continues, but let me get on for a second here. So this is talking specifically about if you own shares of a mutual fund or an ETF and you sell them for a profit, you will create what is called a realized gain. So you go from a potential gain to a realized gain if you sell at a price increase. If it's something you own less than a year, it counts on the income tiers. If it's something you've owned more than a year and a day, it'll count as a long-term gain. But you will pay taxes on the profit that you made when you sell the mutual fund or when you sell the ETF. It's the exact same. But let me continue on. Quote, but you may also owe taxes if the fund realizes a gain by selling a security for more than the original price, even if you haven't sold any shares. By law, the fund must pass on any net gains to shareholders at least once a year. So just straight up, hardcore, flat out, if you own an index fund or if you own a mutual fund or if you own an ETF, and an index fund is a type of mutual fund, or if you own an ETF, and inside of that ETF, there was a change and a stock or bond or whatever asset they hold was sold at a profit, and it realizes a gain, that will be and must be by law passed on to you in that year. Just flat out. That's just how it works. They're not a magical tax dodge. The thing that a lot of people that I've talked to around this subject think of an ETF is that the company goes and they buy 20 stocks and they sit on them and they hold them forever. Okay, if they do that, there might be no realized gains inside of the ETF that they would distribute to you. But an index fund could do the same thing. Now, most index funds, and at Vanguard this is the case, they follow an index. And when the index adds a stock or removes a stock, one has to sell and make trades within the index fund to adjust to the index. The ETF that follows an index does the same fucking thing. So the distinction here is not between ETF and mutual fund. It's between whether you've traded or not traded. If you have an ETF that doesn't trade anything, it would create no taxes internally. If you have an index fund that doesn't trade anything, you will have no taxes from gains, from realized gains internally. It's the same rules. They apply. So if you ever hear someone say ETFs pay no taxes or can't pay taxes or don't have to pay taxes, and then the very next sentence in the original email, I will quote from the listener, quote, they never need to pay out capital gains as they don't have any. Both parts of that are just flat out wrong. If they sell something, now if they don't sell anything, fine. But if they sell something and they have a realized gain, they have capital gains. And as Vanguard said, by law, they must pass on that gain to you, the investor, and you will, according to your own tax tiers, pay the tax on those gains. So
That was two profoundly wrong things in a very short sentence or partial sentence. They never need to pay out capital gains. False, as they don't have any. False. Just cold heart, I am so sorry that you are in the position where you think that is the case. And again, I provided the link and even the quote in the email for you to look. And of course, any listener, if they want it, they can ask me for it as well. Then we get on to this kind of muddled and confused discussion of spread and NAV. I don't know about discussion. I wasn't able to correctly interpret the words that were written to me in the email. And this may be a problem with Phil. Just ask my wife. I have really hard time where my mind will interpret something literally, even though from the context, the average human being would know that my interpretation is wrong. Kind of like, oh my God, what's that? That's the guy in Sheldon on Big Bang. Kind of like that. Sometimes it drives me nuts, but sometimes I just can't fucking help myself. So maybe this is one of those situations. But here is the text from the email. This spread between NAV and market price is actually already accounted for by the bid ask spread. Unless I'm totally misreading that, that is as false as something can be. The NAV and the difference between NAV and the market price is a totally different subject, a totally different concept, functions in a totally different way than the bid-ask spread. So putting them together in one sentence, putting them that one solves the theoretical problem from the other, No, I cannot abide by this. This just doesn't work for me. And for this to just not only rely on Vanguard, I searched around in Fidelity to see what I could find. And I now find that I have to make this bigger so I can read it if my computer wants to play along. All right. Here is the quote from Fidelity. The important thing to remember is that ETFs generally trade close to their fair value, NAV, and premiums or discounts tend to be short-lived. However, that's not always the case. So dig deeper before snapping up a fund simply because it's trading at a discount. You may have to sell at a bigger discount. I went to a website. This is called The Street. The Street ETF Focus. This is from April of 2020. I could find other things. This just came up on the top of the Google search. The title of the article, ETFs with the largest premiums and discounts to NAV. So you could have an ETF that follows an index, or by the way, an ETF can be a managed fund, just so you know, which would make it far worse than Vanguard index funds, secondo me, in my opinion. But this is a website that shows some of the variance from NAV. So again, just a quick recap, NAV, net asset value, that is the theoretical, best calculated actual value of everything owned by the ETF. The ETF trades in the market. Again, one of the perks, one of the problems. It trades in the market. If supply and demand are not equal, the variance from NAV can be quite significant. So here there is one, DWCR, the Arrow DWA County Rotation ETF. I have no idea what that means. But at the time of this article, it was trading at an 11.79% discount as compared to NAV. So if you owned all the underlying assets on your own, you would get the net asset value. If you own this ETF and you want to sell it, you are going to lose at least 11.79%. And as Fidelity pointed out, you might have to sell it below what it's trading at to get out, because that the reason it's that low is nobody wants it. On the other end of the spectrum, in this issue of The Street, the ticker symbol FLV, American Century Focused Large Cap Value ETF, was trading at a premium of 9.45%. Those are fucking huge. That's a really big deal. Now, if you're buying a very large ETF, one that follows the S&P 500 or the QQQs, the one that follows the S&P 500, the most famous one is SPY, Spider, the triple Qs, followed the NASDAQ. These are huge. There's transactions every millisecond, probably during the trading day. The variance from net asset value is probably always going to be insignificant. But if you want a broadly diversified portfolio of different things like I use with the mutual funds are only priced once a day, but they are actually at net asset value, where if you buy categories and subcategories of ETFs that specialize in the certain things that I'm using for the index funds, you are now adding maybe a small, but you are adding another variable that I think could go against you. And it might be that the very moment you want to sell something is at the very moment someone else wants to sell, or a lot of people want to sell the same something. So you add that extra risk. So I think my concern over net asset value stays. Next, I'm not going to read you the quotes, but the author of the email talks about spread and made some scenario where if the bid is $100 and one penny and the ask is $100 even, and the net asset value is 99.99, which, okay, that's trivially small, which just agrees with their prior point that if there is a difference, it's trivially small. It's not always trivially small. Why would the company go in there and buy and or sell? And my response is that's a straw man argument. I did not say that when there's trivially small differences that the creator of the mutual fund would go in and buy or sell. It wouldn't be necessary when you're talking about one penny variance on a $100 price. I did not make that claim. So I'm miffed that you would argue this and say that that's never going to happen. I would agree. It's never going to happen. I didn't say that it happens. So don't be like that. And then the next sentence from the email, this is why NAV very closely tracks the market price. No, it's not. I think there's this confusion with the NAV and the spread. And I don't know how to reconcile that, at least in the way I'm reading the email. And again, this could be a problem. So we talked about the variance in market price versus the NAV, and that can be real and material. Not likely to be too material with really large, high volume, high velocity ETFs that sell a lot, tens of millions of dollars a day. Fine, fair enough. And I'm not going to read you the next part, but there's a theoretical calculation where it might cost $35 to buy a mutual fund. If you have $100,000, it might cost $35 to buy a Vanguard index fund. Now, if your account is at Vanguard, it's zero. Unfortunately, TD Ameritrade and Schwab and everything that I have and all my clients' assets that are at TD Ameritrade is going to Schwab, there is a transaction fee. In this example, the author of the email used $35 and then made the claim that ETFs, the spread is usually around 1 basis point. Their math is not wrong. And so in this situation, they're saying $35 versus $10. I thought it got a little overly convoluted by going to basis points because the $35 cost is $35. But anyway, the point of their email is that in this situation, a $100,000 transaction might cost you $35 to buy or sell the index fund, and it might be $10 to buy or sell the ETF when you include the spread, assuming wherever you are and you're buying or selling the ETF, if there's not an actual transaction cost. This is just the spread. Depending on where you are, the transaction cost might be zero. It might be zero only on some ETFs. It might be 10 or 20 bucks. If it's a place where you call in or go online, depending on their fee structure, it could be considerably higher. But there is a theoretical possibility that if you have a firm that holds your money where the transaction cost of an ETF is zero, and if the spread is only 0.1%, 0.01% or 1 basis point, that the transaction cost would be smaller for the ETF. And it's so interesting that the additional comment from the email, this is so small that it's negligible. I agree. I think honestly, for a $100,000 transaction, $10 or $35 is negligible in both cases. But I disagree with the spread being 1 basis point. It is possible. It might even be likely, again, with the massive, huge ETF like the Spider or the Triple Qs or something like that. But even then, it's generally not. So I went to and I found a website called ETF.com. Why trading spreads matter for ETFs. You surely can go find some other page, but if you want, I can send you this link. But if you go to ETF.com and look up why trading spreads matter for ETFs, written by Sumit Roy, apparently, is his name, on January 30th of 2019. Yes, it's a couple years old, but I think it so elegantly explained this that they did a bunch of research and they found out that in the U.S., for stock-based ETFs, the average spread trading ETFs was not 1 basis point. It was 48 basis points. What? Well, that's a big difference. Now, they go on further to argue that that might be artificially too high because it's an average. So instead, let's look at the bigger funds being cheaper and the smaller funds being more expensive than 0.48, which gets to my point, is that instead of 48 basis points, you might pay 60, 80, 90 basis points if you're trading an ETF that is not huge. It can be worse than that, but that's getting pretty high. But the average they said is 0.48. However, if you take into consideration which funds are being traded and what volume, it's probably more likely that the average paid by an investor is 20 basis points. Again, not 1 basis point, as expressed by the author of the email. They go on further and consider that given the size of the large funds, given the asset weightings of the funds, in the really big ETFs, if you squint and look just the right way, you know what? There is a possibility that the spread for the really big boys might be 4 basis points. And you might argue, okay, 4 versus 1, not much of a difference. But in the calculation that I was given in the email with $100,000, if the transaction cost is not 1 basis point or the spread is not 1 basis point, but 4 basis points, that means buying the index fund is $35 and buying the ETF is $40. So in that case, it's not cheaper. So you have either a point where the cost, give or take, for almost anybody investing, the difference is not really relevant on the really big, highly liquid funds. And when you get up to larger portfolios, trading in the ETFs versus buying or selling shares of the fund, at least of some kind of size, the ETF, there is a definite possibility it could be more expensive. Well, the funny thing is that if you're buying these at a place that has, at Vanguard, let me be specific to Vanguard, you're buying Vanguard ETFs, the transaction cost is zero, but you're still going to pay the spread, which is funny because you're going to pay the spread because you have to get them, or Vanguard has to get them from the market. And if you went to argue that there is no spread because you just get them from Vanguard, well, then you've defeated the very point at the beginning of this whole thing that Vanguard doesn't traffic in the ETFs on the market, which if they gave them to you and just took your money, they would be doing exactly what you claimed they don't do and can't do, which they do and can do. So anyway, but here's some of the lowest spreads, the SPY, the Spider, four basis points, like we talked about. But then there's some here that the spread is 100%. Not too surprising, but Market Vectors double long euro. Okay, well, that's a fancy, crazy game. And either some people really want to get in or they really don't want to get in. And I don't know what's driving the spread, but the spreads on some creative ETFs can be ginormously huge. So comparing the cost of the spread to the transaction cost of buying a mutual fund is most likely small enough that it genuinely doesn't matter. But if you want to, the thing that's much more important, and this is with any fund or any ETF, it's what exactly are you buying is way more important. than the methodology of the investment. And I'm wrapping up, and I'm so sorry. I thought I could do this in 20 minutes. My apologies. If you hate this kind of segment, let me know. If you like the kind of rambling and citing things, let me know that too. It'd be nice to hear something positive, I guess. I go back to the email. For taxable accounts, the fact that ETFs never distribute capital gains is a huge plus over mutual funds. Okay, we already discussed that, flat out wrong. And then he adds, see the recent Vanguard capital gains distribution fiasco. Well, it's funny. In one sentence, you say that they can't and they don't, but look at that case that Vanguard did. Wow. Please don't write self-refuting sentences. Don't claim that something can't happen and then tell me about a horrible case where something happened. And it just so happens that I know about this fiasco at Vanguard, and it came up from their target date funds. We've gone in details, and I may do it again in the future if you want. You can always send me an email, phil@polarisfinancialplanning.com. A target date fund owns stocks and bonds. And as you get closer to the date of the target date fund, or closer to retirement is the theory for you as well, they're going to transition from a lot of stocks to less stocks, and from not so many bonds to more bonds. How do you think they do that? Really? How do you think they do that? They sell some fucking stocks and they buy some fucking bonds. I have talked about some of the concerns that target date funds have. For a lot of people, especially in a taxable account, the problems that exist with target date funds are small enough that they are likely a really good choice, and in some cases, the best choice inside of your 401k. So I'm just saying that because every time I talk about target date funds, someone hears they're evil and they're awful. Depends on the situation. But there was a story that I think was on Reddit or something like that, where this guy got hit with a $150,000 tax bill on his Vanguard target date fund. And what caused this, other than the fact that he has ridiculous wealth and had something like $5 to $8 million in one fund, is that at the end of the year, as per the plan, the fund sells some of its stocks and buys some of its bonds. The market has been up a lot lately. A lot of the stocks they had, a lot of them they had for a long time, had really large capital gains. That's what we want. Really large capital gains. In this case, the investor received a capital gains of $500,000. So even though only a small part of the fund moved from stocks to bonds, because he had millions and millions and millions of dollars in there, the gains that got distributed to him passed through, because they have to be by law, was $500,000. So he, because he was in the high tax bracket, these long-term capital gains, he didn't pay 0% or 15% or 20%. He paid 23.8%, which is the top tier of capital gains long-term tax rates, plus an additional 3.8%, which I'm not going to go into now, but he paid 23.8%. And so he had a tax bill of $150,000. Boo fucking who, right? Boo fucking who. If he had an ETF that was a target date ETF in a taxable account, and it changed the allocation from stocks to bonds, if that ETF had significant long-term capital gains like the target date fund that he had, you would have the same exact fucking problem. So what is called by some as a fiasco by Vanguard is Vanguard doing exactly what they told you they were going to do. Now, the one possible rational argument that has merit is maybe Vanguard should have made it more clear, bigger bold letters or something that in red, that by the way, if you own this in a taxable account, this could be a problem for you. It would be the same thing if you had the target date ETF. You're going to have the same tax. We already covered that. How do you avoid this, you ask yourself? Well, one, if it's in your 401k, you don't pay any tax on it. Woohoo, problem solved. Well, you pay taxes when you take the money out, assuming you live long enough to take them out. That's a whole nother subject. But you're not going to pay any taxes or have any, well, your tax rate will be zero. Your tax will be deferred on all the transactions that happen within that target date fund, whether it's an index or an ETF. If you have a taxable account, theoretically, what would be much nicer as you get closer to retirement, let's say you have $2 million, you're making a good chunk of money, and you want to move 5% of your portfolio from stocks to bonds in that given year. So let's see, 5%, that's $100,000 out of $2 million, right? I think I did that off the top of my head. If you are in the position where you're making good income, and one would hope that you are, especially if you have a $2 million portfolio, if you had the ability to save $100,000 that year, you could take the $100,000 that's new and put that 100% in the cushion or in bond funds, and therefore you don't have to liquidate stocks and create a tax liability to change your portfolio to a more conservative position. Huh? Pretty nice. Now, if you can only save $50,000, maybe you do half and half, but you might also have the ability where all of the bonds pay dividends and all of the stocks, all of the index funds pay dividends. And this is one of the little tricks that I do that is not the industry standard or the industry norm. All mutual funds that I use, and they're almost all index funds, I have the dividends and appreciations all pay as cash back into the account that you are using. So if you have a joint tenants account, you and your spouse, and when a mutual fund pays dividends, it goes to cash, not repurchasing additional shares. And you might say to yourself, but Phil, that's slightly less efficient because the money's not being reinvested automatically. There is merit to your point. It's not quite as efficient. But one of the things you can do with that, as all these bonds and stocks pay out, let's say a theoretical 2%. So out of this $2 million, there might be $40,000 of dividends in the calendar year. If you are transitioning to a more conservative portfolio, you can take that $40,000, and every time you get dividends, and they don't all occur in one day, an ETF might all come at the end of the year, by the way, but index funds are usually, and all mutual funds and all stocks, usually are paid quarterly, but sometimes the months in between the quarters, you'll get small amounts. The biggest chunk is in December, just in case you had any questions about that. But if you see that you've gotten an extra $2,000 or $3,000 in dividends, and you know you're moving towards a more conservative position, you have $3,000 in dividends. Instead of reinvesting back in the stock index funds, you go in and you take that $3,000 and you buy a bond index fund. You do that through the whole year, you might have $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 that you've invested in bonds. You didn't have to sell anything. Now, you do have to pay tax on the dividends, but you were going to pay that no matter what. But you can avoid reinvesting it and then having to sell something to be able to transition to bonds or increasing the size of the cushion. That might be $30,000 to $50,000 on this $2 million portfolio. And then, of course, if you're adding another $50,000, you can transition slowly over time, which is part of the reason the plan works that fucking way, while creating almost no taxable activity and very little taxable events inside of a taxable account. If you have a target date fund, they will do what they do and they don't care how it affects you because they can't. They have millions of investors in that specific fund. They just do what they do. And if you happen to have millions and millions, 5, 8, 10 million, I don't know what the exact number this guy had, in there and you're in the top tax bracket, they don't serve you. It's really hard sometimes for people with hundreds of millions of dollars to understand, but you might get a tax bill. Anyway, 42 minutes, right? 42. 42 is a magic number. We all know that. So maybe this is a good thing. 42 minutes, not 20. I'm just going to stop. I'm done. That's all I'm going to talk about this for a while. And we'll take a quick break and go into something else.
I think there'd be more atheists and less faithful if you weren't allowed to teach anything. You weren't allowed to mention any gods or any beliefs or atheism, right, until they were 20. I think we'd see a different pattern. The human brain, when it's young, is a sponge. It has to be. It has to take in all the information. It has to trust its parents, its elders, to survive. Without question, don't touch the fire. Why not? Don't go near the don't go near the wolf. Don't touch that spider with a red belt. Don't touch that. Why not? Just don't. There is a God. What? There is a God. And if you're bad, you go to hell. Okay? And if that's constantly confirmed, like all the other things, wolves eat you, black widows kill you, fires burn you, if it's given that same level of credence and truth, you're never going to get over it. It's going to be a lot harder to undo that. I think the myths came up, maybe, you know, often as a stopgap to knowledge until we find out more. You know, the earth is flat, and no, we've proved now, okay, the earth's not flat, we were wrong, okay? But that's not personal. You don't take that personally. It doesn't affect you. It doesn't affect your afterlife, you know? And so they often want to hold on to that, right? But only because of the way they've been conditioned. We know it's fun to tell children there's a Santa Claus and there's fairies at the bottom of the garden and all these cute things. It's cute till they're 7 or 8. If they're 34, it's a bit embarrassing socially. This is my son. What's he doing? He's looking for fairies. Is he? Okay, we better leave. If you're born in India, you're probably a Hindu. If you're born in America, you're probably a Christian. If you're born in Pakistan, you're probably a Muslim. That's a coincidence, isn't it? That you're always born into the right God. Always, isn't that lucky? I was born into the right God. All those others are going to hell. But I was born into the right religion. I'm going to heaven. It's strange that we hold on to these sort of medieval beliefs. You know, where did the universe come from? God made it. Which doesn't solve the problem for me. Because we straight away say, well, who made God? And if they say, well, he's always been around. Well, let's just say the universe has then. Let's just cut out the middleman. It saves time.
The Phil Ferguson Show is for educational and entertainment purposes only. Nothing said on the show should be interpreted as personalized investment advice. Investments should be based on your personal situation, and you, of course, should consult with your financial advisor or tax professional before taking any actions.
You're listening to The Phil Ferguson Show.
Thank you for listening once again. Of course, the show is a little more technical than a lot of shows, and even with that and my concern that it's too technical, I do have some follow-up items on the subject of ETFs and ETF costs in relationship to the email that I got. I sent all the information that I had in the segment just minutes ago to the author of the email, and he responded, probably responded nicer than I deserved, because I can be a little snarky or maybe even condescending when I write an email, especially when it starts with the idea that I am grossly misinformed. But to be fair, in their response, I had mentioned in the segment that BlackRock SEC filings show that they can go in and trade shares. He was able to find some additional information that suggests that they generally don't do that. So, in my original piece, where I suggested that BlackRock may benefit from going in and transacting in their own ETFs, probably not in a significant amount. Usually other parties are doing that. And again, this is more detail than I want to get into. Other parties are doing it. And whether they do or don't make money, I don't have that information, but I'm sure they make enough money to cover the effort of doing it. So it still exists. It may be small, it may be trivial, and in the specific case of BlackRock, they just flat out may not do it. I did find on a Vanguard website, I closed it already, sorry. But basically, they also do the same unless you have millions of dollars and want your cash directly from Vanguard. So that might be still a possibility. Again, we're talking about things that are so small of a difference. The other thing is in the response email from the listener, he talked about, well, I'm only talking about the super big, large ETFs. Okay. That there is a distinction between the super large and the not super large ETFs. And I discussed that in the segment. I didn't read it as their point that only the two or three biggest funds would be cheaper. And maybe the transactional cost on the Vanguard S&P 500 ETF is small enough that you could buy that and save it a few dollars. Interestingly, they suggested, the author of the email suggested, that these are things that are so small that they don't really matter. Well, cool, but you brought it up in your email. Another ETF that they suggested was as a very large ETF that can be traded easily on the market is VB. That's the Vanguard Small Cap ETF. But when I looked it up on ETF.com, it says that the average spread is 0.09%. Again, not the 0.01% that the author suggests is the norm, and only the really big funds. So you would have a situation with a $100,000 investment, instead of paying a $35 transaction fee outside of Vanguard or a $0 transaction fee inside of Vanguard, you're going to have a very small, we're talking about small amounts here, but instead of paying zero at Vanguard, you're still going to have to trade, and you're going to pay 0.09% or about $90. So if you're at some other platform and you're thinking $35, $45 to buy a mutual fund, I can avoid that fee, which you can, and you can go buy the ETF version of that fund. Just keep in mind that while the differences on the really big popular funds is probably trivial and not really worth merit, you're not saving money. And if your trades are big enough, you're going to actually spend more money trading the ETF than paying the transaction fee that you might have to pay. So in this case, with the VB ETF, you might be out $90. Again, 90 out of 100,000. So we're getting to the point where we're having a delightful nitpick of very, very, very small percentages. But I'm coming from the position where people often tell me, like I kind of felt like this author had done in the first email, and the second email is much more clear. So kudos for that. But in the first email, the idea that these costs don't matter. Okay, well, if they don't matter, then they don't matter when you're buying the mutual fund. So if they don't matter, they don't matter. I also found an additional source here. This is advisorinvestments.com. I don't particularly know the website, but it's what came up here. And it says, from where we sit, the only reason to invest in Vanguard ETFs over open-ended Admiral share peers if you're looking to trade throughout the day, which is what I've talked about. The paragraph before, again, from this website, Vanguard's index funds enjoy an upside over those of other companies since Vanguard ETFs and open-end index funds are share classes of the same fund. The open-end index funds come with the same tax advantages as the ETFs. There is a minuscule difference between the tax after-tax returns. So if the author wants to default back to just Vanguard ETFs to argue for the best ETFs, fantastic. Then I can fall back, as I always do, of talking about Vanguard's index funds. I think there is either no difference or meaninglessly small differences. So I still am going with the position where if you have a choice to buy mutual funds or ETFs at Vanguard or some other place and you're buying the Vanguard index funds, I like the idea that you cannot trade within the day. That prevents you from doing something stupid, which is far more of a problem potentially for an independent individual investor than whether you're paying 0.01 or 0.02 for some transaction cost that doesn't happen that often. Anyway, that's enough of that. More than enough of that. I hope you enjoyed the bulk of the show, and maybe we'll do something a little more fun next week, or not next week, next show. I got to say it that way, next show. Again, thank you for listening. Have a fantastic day, and I hope to see you soon. Ciao.
created time for his own glory. He predestined me for eternity.